G'day, g'day. Welcome to a 3v3 on Fragtown. And we are here to watch Shota and Konos on the British Commonwealth. And they're up against the UK chaps Nat Nat. And we also have Handzy in the cast with me today.
G'day everyone, I'm just stepping in whilst I've finished exams and we're going to be watching a bit of Hungary versus British Commonwealth action. Pretty excited to watch these players play in their 2v2 teams before the tournament. It'll be good to see who and what we're going up against, as we can see there's a nice bit of spread over on the southwestern point, or the western point, or however you want to say it for the rest of the map, Strat. But yeah, there's a nice little machine gun emplacement from player two, which I believe is Konos over on that flag.
Yeah, that's the airfield. I like to call it the airfield. Looks like an airfield. I'm pretty sure it is. A few planes over there, if you can see, Handzy. And he's got a regular squad, and he's up against... Who's that player? Oh, that's frustrating. Who's the other player on the UK team? That's...
Player is Nat Nat, but player, as you know, Godwin is quite the ladies man, is obviously the player with the A.
Yes, and Nat Nat's up against Konos, and I guess Shota is marking his way in centre. He's going to get that Nat Nat in there as well with Godwin, both of them going inside, and they've managed to grenade the point to death, and it looks like no one's capping it. Northern East, the town area, as you can probably better to call it the town area in the airfield, instead of the northwest, east, south. Player, oh, this is so confusing. Godwin has got that point. So interesting teams. Wild Hunt are definitely the ones I will pick to win this game, because they came off winning the last tournament, and Godwin and Nat just haven't really performed UK chaps in tournaments, so wonder if they can do well.
Yeah, they haven't performed, I guess, to their own expectations. As we see over on the town side of the map, Guero, or Shota, has gone with a very early Piat. I like the early Piat play, using it to kill infantry. You can get it over the top of those walls pretty easily. You can shoot it around some corners as well. Unfortunately, it's sitting back. Oh, here we go. It makes a bit of a move now. It's going to try and take out these SMG soldiers of the Hungarian sitting behind the walls. And there we go. There's the shot, and there's the kill. Kills two soldiers. Very, very effective use of the Piat early on. It's 4-0. British Commonwealth just going mass infantry early on, also with a bit of a response from Godwin over here on the town side of the map with a few SMG guys. The middle is all Hungarian, and the airfield is all British Commonwealth.
And the sneaky Piat makes its mark again. Shota using his superior micro just to shoot the Piats over the walls, taking out most of the SMGs, and he's going to micro Godwin off the point. And yep, that is Godwin, just confirmed player. And on the southern point, we've got Nat Nat coming in again with another assault squad. No escalation yet. And a massive sandbag line, very Eastern European style, from Mr. Konos onto the airfield. It's full of sandbags now. It seems like it's
thoroughly.
It's
thoroughly
a bit different to your sandbags,
the,
though. I don't know, Handzy. It's more like a Tedesa Konostaga style. You don't split them out one by one like that, do you?
I don't split them up as well as Tedesa, I guess. That's probably the only flaw in my brilliant sandbagging philosophy. But Nat Nat has gone with a Flak 38 AA gun back here. It's smart. It's a very smart thing to do against the sandbags, I guess, because the best counter to sandbags is usually anti-infantry, as it's going to be able to cut through them very well. The one hero point is out, as we see the King African's Rifleman. I've been told by Jutska that they're pretty much elite marksmen, so I'll be buying them every single time. And you can see the Flak tearing through about four or five KAR soldiers, probably the whole squad. Wow. There, except for the one over on the right-hand side, who is putting down an AT mine, I believe, or he was before he stopped, which I'm very happy with. And over on the town side, Strat, what's going on over there?
Wow, the Stuart from Shota came rushing in very carelessly, as he usually does, and Godwin has managed to Molotov it, and he's taken it out. So a massive win for Godwin on the western, on the town side. And the Shota hasn't had too much guarding it, but also Godwin doesn't have too many troops reinforcing. He is coming though now with his own flak, and some squads also have a defense, hold the line, guard the flanks special points from both of the UK players. And nothing to point out on this map, emplacements actually do work pretty well due to the trees, especially in the airfield. The HE shells from tanks do struggle to shoot because they hit the trees.
But player two, or I believe it's Konos, has gone with his own emplacement fire back here. There's obviously the guard the flanks AT rifle thingy back there, but the howitzer here from Konos is going to do a lot of damage over on this side, I feel. It's pretty interesting that no one's hitting the middle, as we see just half of that air control tower go down with ease to the shells of that howitzer. I don't know what type of shells it used, but that was pretty damn explosive there. As you can see, the British Commonwealth flying back up to those sandbags. The flak did a good job taking out the infantry as another plane just burst into a fiery ball of mess. Now the flak is probably going to be taken out.
Oh no, nice movement by Konas, rushing in, but Godwin tried to save the day. Grenade on the flak doesn't take it out, and looks like Nat-Nat is saved. Maybe one more throw from Konas may get its mark, and I think it will. Bam, it's taken out. Well played by Konas, seeing a bit of a weakness in the lines. May have to sneak behind the warehouse to take up the flak. And yeah, the QF-13 does fire the 76mm shells. Doesn't have a great arc compared to the M8. But it has a better explosive shell, as we see now, Turan 1.
Yeah, the Turan 1 is an interesting buy. It automatically gets tracked by the little HE lobber. I'm going to say that the HE lobbing thing will probably do a lot better on this map, as it's nice and flat and open, especially this airfield side. I feel as though Nat-Nat might be better... Might be a little bit better for him to attack through the trees at the moment, just so those trees can absorb some of the HE shells, so he can get his infantry really nice and down. You can see that it's only one person defending that flag, so he could really even just chuck a militia squad or something just to keep a bit of pressure through those trees, because they're going to be pretty well covered by the said trees and forest, as Shotter has gone with one of those AA half-track thingies.
Oh yes, that's expensive. No, that's a three special pointer actually for UK. It's very, very expensive, but it's 37mm. And obviously 37mm can do superb damage, especially in a town area. But he's in a dangerous place in the center, and he does take out his own unit. Turan 1 on the other side of the airfield has taken out the QF-13 howitzer. But let's see this beast go. It's been pinged on the map and it's been shot at. It got bounced. The solid thumb 80 rifle emplacement has bounced. And I think it's there you go. Main gun is down and he's got to run away now. Very gung-ho by Shotter, just storming in like that.
Yeah, very gung-ho, but the main gun being damaged. Is it like the 222 or will it keep firing? No, it's definitely like the 222, so main gun means nothing on that truck.
He definitely used that stone wall too. I think he probably planned that, to be honest. You know, he knew he went in rear facing as well, just so he didn't get his engine damaged or the side of the half-track hull. So it was really well played there by Shotter. Godwin storming into the town. He's actually taken that back and he's going to try to cut Shotter at the spawn area.
Yeah, as you can see, they've taken back the middle now, the Hungarians. It was under a little bit of a threat there from the British Commonwealth. That's an interesting unit. I kind of like that half-track. I think I'll have to play with that a few times. It looks like good fun. But there's two 17-pounders, one bought by Konos and one bought by Shotter. This is an interesting tactic. I probably would have gone the 17-pounder myself, but we probably could be about to see some meta game-playing tactics.
Yeah,
game-changing tactics.
Yeah, they are players. You don't want to disregard what they do, because they did win the last TBD tournament, so anything they do right now, I'm going to watch with eagerness to see if this is going to work. It might work, because Crackdown does have a lot of trees. Again, the HE shells will be blocked, and also the QF-13, I don't know if you know, most of the 80 guns did get a buff in decrease of price because of the fast shooting antics of Witzka. So it is a bit cheaper as well. The 37mm, you can see it comes with the HE shells. It looks like damn fun to use, and I think it's at three special points, it might be a bit expensive, but in the combination with the QF-17 pounder, I think that's going to do quite well at the moment.
Yeah, it's definitely fair. It's doing a lot of damage to all these Hungarian units at the moment. You can see the reservists just chilling in the middle. Here comes a Turan 2 from Mr. Player. I'm pretty sure that's the one that lobs the shells, isn't it? Yeah, it's like Panzer N. You can see it lobbing some AP shells. I don't think it's going to get too lucky. It might want to take out that 6-pounder before it tries, that 17-pounder before it tries anything else. The town side is still locked down by Godwin, so still Hungary in the middle is currently going through the British Commonwealth. But over on the airfield side, Strat, not just the southwestern, you pointed out that it is clearly an airfield before, the 17-pounder is doing a little bit of strategical movements in the background. What is it going for?
Wow, it's going pretty close. Maybe the 20mm can far shot it. I think it's actually going to try HE that flag. interesting choice, I guess, is revealed itself. There's no one to really take it out, I suppose, so I guess this wants to take out the flak very quickly. 37mm has decrewed the flak, and we'll be able to actually take it out with HE. That's an interesting thing about this vehicle, as you can see, it's just taken out and is destroying the guys in the trenches as well. It's so nasty, isn't it? If it can't be countered, it's so easy to counter though, but if it's not, it's just going to do so much damage.
Yeah, you really need to jump on and make sure that that is something that you try and counter early, because you can see it's got 22 infantry kills now, as well as a vehicle kill. What vehicle it killed, I can't remember off the top of my head, but yeah, they really need to do something about that half track, because it's doing a lot of damage, and with the 17 pounders, really anything that they bring out, it's probably going to be a risk to even go for that 37mm half track, just because there's two 17 pounders that are going to protect it with ease. The HE shell tank, the Turan 2, is now being hit by the 17 pounder. Looks like, is he fast shooting through the haystack or through the wall? I think it might have been through the wall. But a lot of fast shooting going on with these 17 pounders. Not a bad choice, I guess. They're a very good gun.
Yeah, indeed. I didn't expect them to do that well. Looks like the Turan 2, it's meant to counter that 17 pounder, has been caught with his pants down. Now it's running away. I don't think it's going to a good location to attack it back, so it's just running to safety. And now it's behind the cover of the house. That 37mm half-track vehicle is just going insane. It must be out of fuel very soon. It looks like it is out of fuel. It's just going to go buy a Matador ammo truck. That's probably to refuel that vehicle. Oh, Turan 3 has just taken out the 17-pounder. Did it?
Yeah, I was just watching that. It's got 130mm HE shell range. I'm pretty sure the 17 pounders anti-tank shell range is about 130 as well. 140. So it's 140. There you go. So you can actually hit it without being hit by the Turan 2 if it's behind cover. But as you see, the Turan 3 and Turan 2 team up for a beautiful Hungarian happy time, and they take out that 17 pounder quite easily. It's 2-3 at the moment, or 24-12. They've got double the score at the moment, the Hungarians, as their half track gets taken out over on the airfield side. It's 2-3, correcting myself there, and it looks like that the 50 cal will be grabbed out of that half track by Konos. No, he won't. Actually, he has complete control over this airfield. Holy crap, I didn't actually realize how much control he has over here. I think that might be a Royal Commando squad that he just bought as well.
Yeah, oh really, okay. It looks like, yeah, definitely the airfield's just been totally sandbagged the shit out of. And yeah, the Turan 3 is out from who's that? Sorry, that's Nat.
Nat.
Yeah, the AT armor turret, AT armor hull. But really, against the 17 pounder, that's the perfect gun you want against it. It can definitely penetrate that much at maximum range. So Turan 3 is probably a good buy most of the time versus most nations, but the 17 pounder is actually a good counter for it.
17 pounders really locking down the middle. I think that Turan 2 from Godwin needs to start doing a little bit more work. It's currently 160 meters away from that 17 pounder, so it still needs to find 30 meters of covered territory before it can start lobbing some HE shells over in its general direction. The flak 38 from Godwin is also to the right hand side of the middle, just I guess guarding that that lane to make sure no infantry comes down. It could hit that half track if it's lucky, if he decided to actually shoot down that lane. It is within range. I think it's about 90 meters away at the moment, but they have decapped the middle, which means it's going to stay at 24-19 until someone caps or otherwise decaps a flag. The 17 pounder is still being pinged, as I think it might have just been hit by a HE shell or an AP shell, and the Turan 2 could possibly be coming in for the kill. Oh, no, he's actually going for the half track.
The Turan 3 has taken out the other 17 pounder. I think that's all of the 17 pounders dead on the field now. So no anti-tank capability for the British Commonwealth team, and the 37mm is waltzing back to spawn, waiting for some sort of support. So it looks like the advantage has gone to the Hungarian team, as they are holding three flags and will start ticking up, but not strongly, as the center is now being assaulted with a QF-13 howitzer and a few squads on the left from Konos.
I just want to point out something really quickly as well. Nat has bought two Flak 38s, and Godwin has currently got two on the field. Now, the Flak 38 for Godwin hasn't really been so effective. You can see one of them's got two kills, and the other one is only just got its third kill. The new one from Nat's obviously got nothing, as it's still being pushed up at the front line, and the other one got about 6 or 7 infantry kills. It's 14 minutes and 50 seconds in, and they're going to start being counted pretty easily, as you can see that QF-13 howitzer can probably easily take them out. Have they overinvested in the flak this game?
Yeah, I don't know. I still think flaks are just so valuable to have, like, regardless. It doesn't really matter losing one flak, as it can do so much damage. But as you said, it hasn't really killed much. I think they just haven't used it efficiently, to be honest. We did see that Turan 2 also just take out that 37mm Harpjack, but has not finished it off, as Shota is now repairing it, so it could bite the UK team back in the ass. And an Orlicon buy from player 2, which is Konos, as the Turan 3 now is moving in to try take out the QF-13, I think. Let's see how this goes. There goes one of the flaks.
The QF-13, as you just said, took out another flak, so that's two flaks out of four, and they've killed about 15 infantry all up, give or take. That's being pretty generous as well, as the sandbags go up on the 13-pounder howitzer over here. I'm not a fan of buying an early flak. I'd probably wait a little bit and then maybe situationally buy it, because I know it was Nat's first major buy there, as the Turan takes another HE shell and just misses. The QF-13 is backing off. The airfield is completely dominated by sandbags and British Commonwealth soldiers, and the town is still well and truly Hungarian.
Indeed, the airfield has also been reinforced by an Orlicon in a very interesting position, just his top part of the gun exposed from the trench. And I think he's just given up that area. It's just too much of a hassle to attack. Like, I wouldn't bother to assault that other than if I had pure infantry killer domination. I suppose that was Nat's plan at the start. And perhaps if he did move his flak between the trees to avoid the QF-13 counter, it might have worked well, because the QF-13 would have been useless taking a lot of those trees out, especially in between the center and the airfield. There's a whole clump of trees that the QF-13 would have to fire about 5 or 6 shots to even aim at the flak 38.
Yeah, I can see over here on the town side. Sorry, I'm just watching the Stuart, or the M2A4 light tank, fight against the flak, and it's kind of, you know, when I guess not two immovable objects, but that's a very nice shot there from Turan 2. Was that with an AP shell?
Yeah, it was an AP shell from the Panzer N type Turan 2 vehicle. And it gets on the point again, flak 38, I guess. In the mod, it is less effective to, or more easily countered by light tanks such as the M2A4 Shermans. There's a lot more cheaper light vehicles out in the mod that can counter it out. So perhaps, yeah, you're right that the Flak 38 may not be a good buy at the very start, the first buy or second buy.
Yeah, it feels like it's become much more situational. But as I say that, Nat's Flak is tearing up the middle. It's killed off quite a few British Commonwealth soldiers. They need to get a grenade into that foxhole to make sure that nobody caps the center. It's 27-25. The Britcom have crawled. They haven't really been out of the game, but I guess points-wise, as the QF-13 just takes one shot from the Turan 3 there and just explodes into the 4 or 5 components that build it up, as the 37mm is still got about 50. It's got 50 units of fuel. We'll say litres, just for argument's sake. It's got 50 litres of fuel in it, so it's going to need to refuel relatively soon. That's if it can stay alive, as the Hungarians move slowly in on the centre.
That's an interesting play. You can see Schott has put a Matador ammo truck on his actual spawn, so when he spawns infantry, they reload. I don't know why. It doesn't seem like... I never find problems with troops running out of ammunition, but I guess the worst case scenario, he has that covered. I don't know.
Yeah, definitely. I don't know, maybe they get an extra grenade or two. I don't think that's the case. No. I'm pretty sure you can't really get extra grenades.
Yeah, but, it'll just be the ammunition, like rifle, SMG, pistol-type ammunition. Although that 3 special pointer half-track 37mm is back up and functioning. Fortunately, Goblin did not finish it off, and it's just towed another QF-13. Seems like that's been a huge meta change right there. QF-13 is being spammed outright.
Yeah, it does. The first one, I believe, took out a flak, which was hugely effective. But this one, the last few have been pretty easily countered by the Turan 2 and the Turan 3, as I think the Turan 3's killed two of them. But the Turan 2 has the 130-meter range with the HE, which can just, you know, pick them off from distance, which is quite good. But setting up again once on the middle to try and take out some infantry. He's using direct control as well. I think he's going for that flak. So it's flak versus QF-13 pounder this game, because I think there's been 4 bars of each, and all the flaks are dead except for Godwin's over on the town side of the map.
Yep, repeating itself again. QF-13 takes a flak and now attack to take at the QF-13. Can this be deja vu once again? Looks like Nat does miss, unfortunately, for the UK team. And looks like the QF-13 is not going to go into safety. I thought it was. What actually hit it? That was a 2-round 2 in support from Godwin on the right side. And also a Toldy I 20mm. It's a looks variety of the Hungarian light vehicles coming to the center to hold it.
And just letting you know that the 37mm is currently just being refueled. So there you go.
All right. And finally, I would have thought it would have run out ages ago. That's crazy how long it's been alive. It can basically be counted by an AT rifle if you aim it in the front part, but obviously not at the back as you saw before when it hits the turret or main gun. But yeah, Shota just is lucky with his light vehicles and just gets away with Wow, Piath from Shota takes out the Toldy I. Very nice ambush in the town. And he does
very nice indeed, but here comes the Piat for the Turan 2, and he fires, and that was a very, very good shot, as that was right on the edge of the range. It went straight over that haystack, and then he gets blown up with ease. I think he was just about to fire as well, but the Turan 2 lives to lob another HE shell, and the 37mm is charging its way towards the town. That is where it's going to be most effective.
Indeed.
I feel pinged for some reason, probably for the 15th time, to let people know that it's on the field, that it needs to be killed, as Nat's Turan 3 is going to go to the 37mm side to try and counter it. Bit of an escalation there in armor, but you know, it should get the job done as it's taking out some infantry here on the wall.
Just some conscripts, very nasty indeed. Doesn't really have too much options to flank in the center. I guess it can take out the end, but the Turan 3 is just aimed at it. But to be honest, I think the Turan... Sorry, the 37mm can take it out from the side. Turan 3 does have a pretty bad sidearm. I believe it's similar to the H. Let's have a look. It's got 35 side armor, so it can definitely be side shot from that 37mm.
Yeah, it's definitely not the greatest on the side. It beat.
Oh, Turan 2 being a bit careless as well. I guess they're a bit baiting. It's quite easy to turn, I suppose, as long as they are baiting, as the 37mm decides to fall back for some reason.
20 infantry and 2 tanks at the moment, or 2 emplacements, I guess, because I think a tank counts as an emplacement.
Indeed.
Or rather, emplacement counts as a tank. The middle is currently belonging to Hungary. It's 43-25. They're ticking up. It's 22 and a half minutes in. The town is still all Hungarian, beside the 37mm's best efforts to get itself in there. And the troops from Shota also moving around. Still, that QF-13 is behind the middle. There's a sniper also out from Konos here at the center.
And Matilda Bai from Shota is going to try to make a breakthrough on the town area. I guess this two-pounder gun has got the greatest penetration, but at close range, it can fire faster and be more accurate, so potentially can take out the other bigger Turans around. And he does have quite a few infantry waiting to assault. They look like they're elite squads too. There are the commandos, which is the fourth tier of the British Commonwealth. And here it goes charging in, also with a regular squad. And what's waiting? The Flak 38 is going to be countered probably, and the Turan 3 from Nat's going to come try counter it. Just want to mention on that note from that on that Matador ammo truck by its spawn. I'm pretty sure that's not really worth it. I would probably not do it myself, as it costs 5 CP, and I think that could tip you over the CP, or sorry, payback gain thresholds, and pretty much make you get less payback throughout the entire game.
It's an interesting strategy. I'll have to talk to him to see why he wants to do it. But just on that point, while you were talking, the Turan 2 of Godwin absolutely dominated at the center. It took out the QF-13 pounder, and then also the sniper of Konos, one of the snipers from Konos, was sitting behind the middle, and he just HE'd it first time. So it killed more than it's worth in about 3 seconds than what it has pretty much all game, as it currently has 21 infantry kills and 3 tank or emplacement kills, as there's some smoke grenades going down right now from player 2, which is Konos. I think he's throwing down the smoke so he can hold fire and sneak in the middle. Very, very well played. The town is now currently being dominated by this Matilda and his band of merry, merry reservists. Oh no, they're actually just regular riflemen, so there you go. As the flak has popped back into existence, trying to get some kills off on the infantry. It's going to be quite an interesting battle here, as the Matilda can just really hunker down in that town and get away from the Turian.
Indeed. And there goes that flak that's been decrewed, and Matilda should be able to finish it off. Well, Turian 3 is... Nat's trying his luck through the building. It's going to try shoot to the building and take the track, or maybe get the building to be knocked down. Perhaps maybe take a HE shell on the roof to make it happen a bit faster. Ritual thinking from Nat as a center. Another flak by. Two flaks in the center once again. Wow, they're really spamming the flaks in the center in this game. But no QF-13s at the moment to counter it. As we see that...
Yeah, they've bought...
3 points there again.
Six flaks, which is about 1,040 manpower, wow. By the way. So Jesus. It's really not that good of an investment when they've killed about tops 30 soldiers.
Yeah, I don't know if one even killed that much. A few of them have only killed two soldiers and three, so... Yeah, it's definitely hasn't been working for them this game. And the 2 and 3 goes for a close range encounter for the Matilda, bounces the shot, and the Matilda is not going to go for it. Looks like it's just going to wait. He's the most patient bugger in this battle. Looks like Shotter just is trying to AP snipe that one rifleman. Definitely worth his micro there. And he's been tracked for all his efforts and should be able to be finished up. But he gets a P out from Shotter. Is it going to be running towards it? No, it's not.
No, he's just going to hunker down behind that building, I guess, wait for his time. He nearly gets AP sniped by the Turian. Probably would have been accidental. But I think the Turian 3 should be able to finish the Matilda off from that range. The middle is currently belonging to the British Commonwealth. We are seeing a 4-1 cap, or 4 out of 5 cap, however you want to say it. It's 49-37. They currently only lead by 11 points now as it ticks up to 38.
Jeez.
So it's a bit of panic stations here I'd be pressing for the Hungarians, as the points are going to start to churn up pretty damn quickly, probably a point every 5 to 10 seconds, as the Matilda is hull destroyed and they're not getting into the airfield. So they've only really got two avenues of attack and they need 2 points. So they're going to have to attack pretty damn simultaneously and pretty damn effectively as well, as it's just about to tick up to the 27-minute mark.
They've got quite a bit of infantry on the outside of the town, which they can assault. I think they can overwhelm Shotter if they wish. Looks like they're going to the center trying to use the Turian 3, or the Turian 2 and 3 to support the flaks, which have pretty much held them in the game, to be honest. The two top scorers, Turian 3 has a whopping 101 score. That's pretty much the entire score and more of some of the players in the game. It's Turnus's entire score, 68, and Turian 3 on its own has got 101 score. Been massacring a lot of things on the field. As the flaks are being crewed, but really, I think they've got the units on the field to do so. The classic tough tank and the infantry killer combo in the center. And really can't be countered unless they take out the Turian 3, but it looks like they haven't been going any sort of tank destroyer route, the British Commonwealth. Oh.
No, they haven't, but Konos has just bought possibly my favorite unit in the game with the 25 pounders coming out, the old Royal Artillery. I'm a big fan of that. And also, Shotter has gone with the massive get out of my face 3.7 inch Megadeth gun. I'm trying to think of its name. It's just there we go, the veteran AA. Jeez, I'd get there one day, but the 25 pounder is going to be doing a lot of work, as they're going to have to use infantry to get in on that middle point. They are capping it though at the moment. They have taken the town back, so it's 49-49, and this is shaping up to be a little bit of an arty war, and I think that means you're in for the long haul as the turret damage comes up on the Turian. I don't know what that was from. Probably that massive 3.7 inch back there.
Exactly. It's been DC'd by... Shotter has taken it out with the final shot. Has a better reload rate and accuracy than the normal 3.7, and also comes with the Bedford AA 14mm as a tow. A very expensive tow indeed. But very expensive special point at 7 special points just for an AA gun, which can be countered by Artie. 25 pounders doing a decent job. It did take out the flak. And we'll be able to, I guess, pound away at the center at Clump's infantry as it's doing right now. So, yeah, the flaks have been countered very well, I think, by the Hungarian team. And now it's 49-50, and it's very even, surprisingly. I didn't expect the UK chaps to be doing so well.
The UK chaps are definitely giving the British Commonwealth faction of Shotter and Konos a bit of a run for their money here, as the 37mm, that old mate with 35 infantry kills and one tank and or emplacement kill, it's done well here on the centre flag. It cleared it out, but it still belongs to the Hungarian Empire at the moment. There is a veteran Taz Anthem player, which is Godwin, and also an SFH-18 from NatNat. So it looks like the artillery war is going to set in quite quickly here as we approach the 30-minute mark of the game.
Indeed, it's a great buy though from NatNat to counter the emplacement of the 3.7, and also the SFH can counter the 25 pounders due to its higher explosive and also further range than the QF-25. Just on that note, I want to mention I am aware of the artillery problems, not being that they are OP, but more being they're not that fun to, or I prefer them to be situation, I'm sure most of you do, so they are getting a price increase in the next patch, and also the Taz not being on par with the Panther and Tiger being a bit too good in terms of speed and armor, so that's also getting an 8 SP increase instead of its 7 SP. I'm sure you'll be happy about that, Handzy.
Yeah, no, the veteran Taz is quite good, and the artillery can be used pretty easily, and it just does slow down the progression of the game, I guess. But after 30 minutes, you usually get a slow, slogged out kind of game anyway. But a bit of an increase to artillery would be good, as the Turan 3 goes down quite easily, and Godwin is moving that veteran Taz back just a little bit as we hear the SFH-18 fire its first shell. It lands just to the right of the big veteran AA gun, and here comes that 40mm Bedford to pick it up. It'd be pretty funny if a shell landed it right in between the truck and the gun to make them both explode, but I think that's the end of the SFH-18's volley, and I believe that it gets away safely. Oh no, it's still firing, but the gun is no longer there. The 25 pounder is repositioning, maybe trying to get a shot off on the SFH-18. There is an officer by from Godwin in the background, which I'm happy to see. I haven't seen any other officers from any other player. Actually, no, Konos has got an officer as well, which is probably why I believe that Konos might have bought the veteran AA gun for Shotter, because how much is the veteran AA gun? Is it 7 points?
Yeah, 7.
And that 37mm is 3 points, is it?
Yeah.
I believe Shotter might have bought one QF-13, or maybe he didn't, and maybe he's just gone with those two picks because, I don't know, I kind of lost track a little bit there early on what Shotter was buying.
QF-13's a non-special point, so he wouldn't have changed it.
Oh, there you go.
It must have been his own. Yeah, the 3.7 is taking out the Toldy Eye as well, and Konos, officer, has been a bit lazy. It's not using some binoculars, it's just leaning its hand. Oh, as soon as I talked, it just put his binoculars up. It's okay, never mind.
Yeah, I think he might have heard you there. The 3.7 inch is moving around. It's readjusting its location.
What's NatNat shooting at? It's moved their FSH barrel all the way down. Oh, looks like he's not DCing that anymore. Not sure what he was doing there. Though another QF 25 pounder is lining up for a shot. Looks like it's going to shoot to the left on that flak, perhaps.
Flak would probably be a pretty good target. That one's killed 6. That is a new flak, I'm aware. I've kept track of the flaks, not of Shotter's buys, but I know how many flaks have been bought and how useless they've been. As the Hull Destroy goes up on an M2A4 tank there from NatNat, or Godwin, sorry. I believe he might have been trying to charge and take out the 3.7 inch or the Vickers veteran AA gun or whatever the hell you want to call it in the background, as NatNat is readjusting his artillery and getting ready for a shot on that big monolithic AT gun. The 25 pounder might want to aim its gun a little bit up if it's going to try and shoot over that house. There we go, now it is, as it's going to rain down some artillery on this infantry. 33 minutes and 45 seconds, and it's 61-50. They hold an 11 point lead, although that will be decreasing as the British Commonwealth have captured back the middle. It's 10 points the difference at the moment.
Turan 3 still the king of the top scorers, 101. Second, the 3.7 has come up on the board for killing a few tanks. Let's see if this Taz can make its money's worth. Hasn't been doing too much in this game, and all Godwin being quite cautious due to the 3.7 being out. I'm actually not sure on the stats to see if it can penetrate or not, Handzy. Looking at the Turan...
I wouldn't have a clue, mate. Tanks are not my thing.
Well, the Taz has 120 front body and armor, and it's sloped too, so that's pretty damn nasty. On the British Commonwealth, The 3.7 has the stats on it. No, it's only as a special point, so I can't actually check. Sorry, guys. So I don't know what's going to happen in a frontal engagement. I'm guessing the TAS will be able to deflect the 3.7 at maximum range. That's my guess, anyway.
That's what I'd be thinking. But Nat bought a Stu 42, but it's in a Hungarian kind of version, a Zrinil 243M. So, you know, there you go. If you wanted to know the specific name of it, I probably absolutely butchered the pronunciation there. As the middle is kind of being decapped by the Hungarians, but that little Anzac soldier, there he is, player two. I can't see his name. It's Martin Bailey. He's got two big infantry kills, which have kept his team the flag at the moment.
And I can't believe this 37mm armored vehicle, which can get killed by anything, is still alive. Shotters managed to sneak it out of danger every time it gets into it. 3.7 is trying to line up a shot, I think. It's moving a bit closer, a bit too far to target the TAS at this stage. TAS has yet to really make an impact on the field, but I guess its purpose is to counter big units. But really, I guess versus British Commonwealth, there isn't any big units to kill. So I suppose, I'm not too sure why, but I guess they can be safe from the 3.7.
Yeah, they can definitely be safe from the 3.7. I don't know if the 3.7 would be able to pen it, but I'd say it'd be an interesting engagement if we ever get to see it. But Schotter is now moving the 3.7 inches gun, and he's found a target. I don't know what that was. It was the Toldy 1, actually. He's just trying to finish that off as the SFH-18 is lining up a shot, and here we go. Here comes the first shell, and it lands, and it gets the 40mm Bedford, but it doesn't kill it. You know? Oh, that's disappointing, but I don't think any other shells will land. To go! As I speak, it just dies to the Drinnel Stu 42.
Oh, what a shot! That was a huge...
He's going to change the game.
Oh, you're a bit ahead of me. I just saw that.
I must be a little bit ahead of you, and I just spoiled it for millions of viewers out there on YouTube, but yeah. Wow, that was very impressive.
Million divided by 100... divided by a million, basically, viewers. You're watching this. As the Taz is rolling in a bit closer. QF-25 pounder still pounding away. I guess hasn't really taken out any big targets. The biggest one has been a FLAC 38 so far. But wow, the Zrenri 2 SPG has taken out the QF-25 pounder and is deflecting the shots from the 2 pounder, as it will quite easily do with its 80mm armor. And now Nat's backing away, using the damage wreckage of that car as a bit of protection so it doesn't get tracked. Well played.
37mm decrewed strats.
Where?
Over on the town side. Oh, he's just jumped back in it though.
Oh, nearly there. Godwin just tried to sneak into it. Looks like he's going to throw a grenade. Has he got a grenade out? Oh, it's a Hungarian one. He probably doesn't have an 80mm. Oh, no. Yeah, very easily countered. As you can see, they had so many FLAC 38s on the field, but for some reason, Schotter was able to avoid every single 20mm bullet in history. Oh. Just, wow.
Until just then.
So Godwin does hold, I guess. No more vehicle of death. Lots of troops from Schotter still on the outliers of the town and will be able to assault if he wishes, as they are leading now, 73 to 61. The UK chaps are going to struggle to get a foothold in the center due to the very well-placed sandbags of Konas. And also flamethrower waiting.
The sandbags are very well placed, but the SFH-18 has just taken out one of the 25-pounders, and I believe it might have taken out the other one before, so there's no more artillery for the British Commonwealth. It's 61-75, a Grizzly tank, maybe, or maybe that's just a regular Sherman. I think it's actually just a regular Sherman here going to the far left-hand side to try and push this point. It's 61-76, 15 points of difference, a flamethrower on the middle here from Konos, which is good to see, as a Nimrod bought from Nat.
Wow, Nimrod, so they've saved that 3 special points to a bit later. 40mm returned the favour, I guess, to the British Commonwealth team. The other QF-25 was taken out by the SPG's Renry 2, by the way, but that also is... Sorry to correct you 100 times, but that is also definitely a Grizzly, Handzy. You can tell because it doesn't have the 50 cal and it's more smooth and round like a baby's bottom.
There we go. I thought it was smooth and round like Greek's bottom, but I didn't want to jump out on a leg and say that it was, but the Taz is going to try and take a shot through the house. No, it's not. It's just going to threaten to take a hot shot through the house. That's one very effective way to kill tanks. It's just threatening to kill them, really. It really makes the grizzly scared, and as you can see, it's turret damage and runs away, and it'll probably return to its watering hole and never come back to this side of town again, as the middle is being decapped by the Hungarians, and the flamethrower is maybe going to die without doing nothing. I would have loved to have seen some juicy burning Hungarians, but my wish will not be fulfilled in this game, as there's a two-pounder out from Konos here, trying to do the damage, and it's got the Nimrod before it's going to be taken out by either the veteran Taz or the Stu-42-like vehicle of the Hungarians. at least at main gun and turret damage, the Nimrod. It's currently 61-82, is a 21-point lead for the British Com, but what do you think from here, Strat? What happens from here?
Oh, nice sneak from Commandos, nearly to the Taz. Yeah, by the way, that Nimrod did get taken out by the QF, it's hull as well, but it's being repaired. What now from here? I think, to be honest, the Hungarian team do have the units on the field to win this game. Score-wise, look at the score, wow, they're definitely in the lead. If you total both nat-nats, actually double nearly both the players on the other team. So score-wise, they've killed a lot more, and probably, do they have more MP? The other team has no MP on the field, and let's see, on the other side we've got nat-nat with no MP. Actually, no one has MP except Godwin does have two special points, so that's pretty much, he's pretty much the only person that can bring out an extra punch to the field. But they already have punches in the field, such as the Taz, and also the Nimrod being repaired. They've got the Zrenri, they've got the SFH. On the other hand, the British Commonwealth only have the score, 82. They've lost the QF 25. They've lost everything. They've got a few ammo trucks at spawn, and that's pretty much it. Oh, sorry, and that Grizzly. So, I think they've totally been outgunned. Even though they do have a score lead, I don't know how they're going to really fight the end game.
What happened?
Huh? What happened?
Oh, wow. You timed out of... You timed out.
Oh, did I?
For a second.
Okay, I just went on my long rant, so it's all right. I guess everyone did hear that, because I'm... basically, I'm saying the British Commonwealth are pretty much screwed in terms of units. They've got nothing. Hello?
Fair enough, I don't think they do, but I'm paused at the 40 minute and 35 second mark, so yeah.
It'll be a bit hard now, the game's nearly over, I guess. But there goes that Grizzly from that Taz 44M. So now the British Commonwealth have no vehicles, but they've still got the flag majority, and I guess that's the problem of having such domination of everything else, such as tanks, and you'll have less CP to buy infantry. And that's why I guess the British Commonwealth are capping the majority of the flags now. Only one flag being held by the UK Hungarians, which they do need a flag back ASAP. Perhaps use their vehicles now in a bit more aggressive fashion, and they should be able to win the game.
Yeah, they probably should be able to, even though I can't see anything that's happening right now. I'll just go off on a limb and say that, yeah, those flags definitely hurt them CP-wise, I guess. And, you know, they've got the 190 MP that they spent for those flags. If they didn't buy two of them, that would have been an extra 380 manpower. That's a Panzergrenadier squad, or maybe even three regular infantry squads. That's six resistance squads kind of thing. And right now, or at the 40-minute mark, they needed a hell of a lot of infantry to spread out all over the map. So who does it look like it's going to win?
Yeah, it's definitely the British... the Hungarians, I think, if they just get a bit more infantry, especially Godwin has two special points, he could buy a narrow cross squad right now as well, just to get infantry on the field. That's all I need, because they've got everything to guard the points. Got the Nimrod repair too, they can get in. The Zrenri to take out any emplacements. And they've also got the veteran Taz, which can kill anything, and also a flak on the town, right of the town as well. So they have all the units on the field, just needs the right placement. And also, yeah, just the officer just went down too from that Stu-42 type vehicle.
I'll probably see that in about 5 or so minutes, so it'll be great.
91-64, but you can see the score, Handy. Look at the score of the player kill counts. Nat-Nat's going absolutely bananas.
Yeah, Nat-Nat does have quite a few points. It's 302 on my camera at the moment, but it's a lot higher on yours.
Oh, 321, not too much difference, but pretty much double nearly the opposing team score individually.
He's done quite well this game now, and he's made the smart buys as well with that Stu-42 kind of tank. The Nimrod late has been a masterstroke, really, even though it lost its main gun and turret to the to the two-pounder. But yeah, it's pretty smart work here by Nat.
Yeah, it just can't be countered right now. They can't afford anything. The British Commonwealth have 0 MP, 0 SP, so they're just spamming squads to fill the gaps and try to get their score to tick over just a little bit more, another 9 points or now 8 points to go to win the game, which they could potentially do, and it's probably the only way they can win this game is by snatching the flags by a bit of a rush. It's probably a bit hard to cast right now for you.
It is a little bit. I don't really know what else I can say besides. Well, they bought a lot of flax this game.
the sandbags though, I'm kind of. I was quite sure sandbags were a waste of micro, but that's in my books. But after watching 5TA, you, and now Konos, they're actually quite annoying, especially even if you get the 20mm, you just can't kill enough troops in time to make its money's worth if you split up the troops that well. So I think I'm a sandbag convert, and I might try to practice placing down them more intricately.
Probably should, is it just creates extra cover, I guess, as well, and it's a perception thing as well. Like, you see that many sandbags in a point and you're gonna think, holy shit, how much infantry is actually there? But yet he has none, so I don't know if Nat's kind of just given up over on the airfield, but you can see all those sandbags. He probably doesn't want to go there.
Because what I think, when let's say I buy a squad on the Axis side, there's a big long trench there. I can just throw them in there, and then I can potentially even go further up and steal the other guy's trench and keep going. I don't know, I think that's like Konos's or the 5TA style. They seem to just stay on their sandbag line and just stay there. They don't further up and go more aggressively to attack the next trench. I don't know, that's my thinking anyway. That's why I think the sandbags are a waste, because I'm just going to move on to the next cover.
Yeah, well, it's a very good point, but I guess it gives them a nice base of fire, I guess, a nice little garrison, if you will, garrison point to fire from. And it's always going to be there, and it's pretty much always going to be in their control, because they have the control of their cover, and obviously the cover where the sandbags is, you can see, is probably like a halfway kind of mark to the other trench, and they're probably not going to lose that with the amount of sandbags that they have.
Indeed. I guess the game looks like it's you probably didn't see this, Handzy, but it looks like the Hungarians have got a pretty good hold on all flags. Flak on the town, not counterable, and they're sending their ammo trucks into the battle as well, so it's a sign of giving up, just sending everything to try their best to get a flag. The flak's also in the center, in between the center and the town, so they've got three flags covered very strongly, with also the Nimrod, the Zrenri, and the Taz 44 all guarding it. So it looks like they're going to win slowly, so I'm going to call it now. So whilst the game's, I guess, wrapping up to an end, I just want to ask you, Handzy, what do you think about the alliances patch? Like, what would you be thinking of a good combo? What kind of nation combos were you thinking of?
It is still in beta at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah, it's coming out. They said end of June, but who knows, really. But in a good case scenario, I guess we'll be seeing it in 2 weeks.
Okay, I haven't really thought about it too much, but I guess if you could combine two factions that had a really, really strong early game and then a really, really strong late game, I think that would probably be a recipe for disaster. I don't know, maybe the... I wouldn't really know. But USA and like who has a strong late game from the Allies faction.
Oh, you mean mix up like...
can't really think off the top of my head.
Like thinking about matching up early nation with a long nation so they'd be a bit more well-rounded, I guess, is what you're saying?
Yeah, definitely.
Yep, okay. Yeah, like a USA nation, I suppose it's a bit rushy. I guess British Commonwealth is similar to USA, but in a different aspect. Instead of the rifle firepower, they get the light vehicles, and you could probably match them up with definitely not China. China's probably clumped in that too. Full on rushy as well. I can't think of one either. There's UK.
Yeah, China would be a very rushing nation. Yeah, the UK wouldn't be too bad, I guess, if you had someone say for like a Centurion or something like that, but that's not the greatest late game tank.
Yeah, they don't have any good special late game tanks. Who else is there? There's... Hmm.
I think it would probably be a little bit easier on the Axis side, I guess. You could team up an early game faction like Japan, I guess, with their light tanks and rushing with, I don't know, with maybe even a Hungary, because they get the veteran Taz and stuff like that, and will dominate later on in the game with their bigger tanks. I suppose that wouldn't be too bad of a combination. I've always wondered how Germany and Japan would go together as well.
Yeah, I guess so. Well, what do you think about the going the same nation? So let's say you don't want to choose alliances. Would that be an actual good thing to do? Like both players go UK instead of one choosing a separate nation?
Well, it depends the kind of faction. It depends if it's like a balanced... I don't know. It depends on the faction you're versing, and I guess it depends on the map you're playing as well. I guess if you're playing on a map where you know you had to win early, I guess both players going USA wouldn't be too bad of an idea. True. But then again, you can have one go USA and use the USA rush, and then one go the UK and use their infantry spam and just have pressure galore, really.
Yeah, it's too much. I mean, the possibilities, I guess it's a bit hard to tell, but there's so much potential for combos. You're missing out on if you choose the same nation, I guess. So that's one of the arguments. There was one idea that was put forth to give bonuses to people who don't choose alliances, such as both players choosing USA. If they both choose USA, they get like a rifle percentage boost or something, like -5 MP costs for all rifles or something. I don't know. But that was being thrown in the bin because...
That's a pretty good idea there, yeah.
But some people think it's stupid because it will stop people from actually going the alliances, which was the whole purpose of this patch, etc. So, I don't know.
Yeah, which is fair enough. I'm pretty sure... I think it should be toggleable, like when someone hosts the game, if they want alliances in their game or not. I don't think it should be like... always be able to choose. You've played the beta patches. Is it like toggle?
Yeah,
is
you can
like
toggle it.
Choose like alliances on, alliances
yeah,
off.
Exactly.
That's a good idea. It's not for every single game.
Yeah, it's definitely on and off. You basically choose that. But when you choose the alliances, you can group them in. You can group alliances basically. It's not like all allies in one group. You can have. You can only play USA and UK together. You can only play Soviets and China together, for example. So you can do it that way as well.
Oh, okay, that's a good idea. Yeah.
I think for the mod, I'm going to just put everything in Allies and Axis just so we can choose in the 2v2 tournament.
Yeah, that sounds like a good idea. It'd be interesting to see a Soviet and Finland combination.
It's not possible.
That would be one that I'd be a bit scared of. It's not possible, is it?
Yeah.
No, that's a good point. Yeah.
Axis and Allies.
Yeah, well played.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah, but it'd still be interesting to see that. Might have to try and set that up, because that would be pretty interesting, I feel.
There's two super SMGs, I guess, and one...
Oh,
spamming.
And both Shotta and Konos left quite a while ago, I believe.
Yeah, I did notice that.
Just check
yeah.
the scoreboard, and they both got X's
just
there.
Just sort the banter. Keep the banter going. Anyway.
Keep the chat going, that's fair enough.
That's pretty much game, I guess, so well done to Nat. It's a bit of a sign, a predictor of what's to come in the tournament. There's pretty much no... teams that are going to dominate, in my opinion. There's 5TA, there's Wild Hunt, there's even the UK chaps, which can prove to win anyone. There's also the sweet 2K4 and Liam team. I think it's Liam or Framaz, and they've beaten 5TA a few times in Prax 2, and obviously us, with me being shit now and you having to carry me, we may not do well as well, so anyone's tournament, hey.
Yeah, I'm going to have to be carrying around a lot of Nurofen because my back can be pretty sore when I carry you through yet again another tournament. Now, who's Judska playing for? What team's he on?
Oh,
I'm sure
about
that team will be quite dangerous.
Yeah, I forgot about that. He's playing with... who is he playing for, actually? Oh, Chino, I think. I think he's going with Chino.
That's always a good combination. I like when Judska
Sorry.
And Chino play together.
No, I'm wrong. Yeah, they cancelled. He's going with Simons.
Okay. Oh, that'll be good fun.
not as good with Simons in there.
No, I enjoy seeing Chino and Judska play together because I think they're a very, very formidable force when they're on the same team. But, you know, Simmers could play like Chino, I guess. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, I don't mind Simmers. It's a bit slower, but interesting to see how the personality clashes there. We've seen the clash a few times. It'll be funny to see the dramas involved. That being said, sorry, I don't think the UK guys are playing Nat Nat. Actually has to go traveling, so this is going to be a tournament without Nat Nat for once, and it might be the most smoothest tournament ever run in history.
Yeah, it looks like if Nat Nat's not here, it's probably going to be a quite easy to organise tournament, I guess.
Okay, enough of the bands, I guess. Yeah, so thanks for coming along, Handzy. Thanks for watching. See you guys around.
No problems.